Ed Gein. An anonymous local farmer was the chief model for Norman Bates's personality.
Ed Gein was a man born in America in 1906, who grew up in a problem family. The father was alcoholic, permanently unemployed, and he beat his wife. His wife would roll on the floor screaming and praying to the Lord to have her husband die as soon as possible. He grew up on a farm initially. Then his parents changed occupation and bought a butcher's business. So Gein began when he was 6 or 7 years old, seeing bloody scenes on a daily basis. He'd see his mother cutting up pigs, ripping out their entrails. To him, it was a daily event.
Ed Gein had a big secret. Deep down, it was his passionate desire to become a woman. But instead of quietly pulling on stockings and a dress at home, he disinterred women's bodies to dismember them.
Gein was looking for something fundamentally simple in these graves. That is, he wanted to change into a woman, so he would salvage the faces of these women he had selected. He would salvage the breasts, he'd recover the vulvas, and then he'd make masks. He made himself a torso from various pieces salvaged here and there, which he'd wear on the night of the full moon and dance in his garden or in the woods.
The cemetery soon lost its interest for Ed Gein. He then turned to the women in his circle of friends, who were quite alive.
I think we can estimate around a dozen additional victims by adding all the disappearances and all the corpses recovered at his place for which there has never been any explanation.
Upon his arrest in 1957, Americans were struck by the atrocity of his crimes. Ed Gein immediately became an horrific legend fueled by a fascinated press. Like a character from a horror tale, there are nursery rhymes and songs devoted to him.
There'll be Gein where that's made of embalmed ladies, a heart in a frying pan and lips on a string, some scraps and fats and skeletons, as sure as you're born. The ugliest of all was using corn.
Ed Gein, killer and handyman, would make everyday objects out of the skin of his victims, like this leather chair, for example. Amazed to learn that these crimes took place just a few kilometers from his home, writer Robert Bloch's imagination kicked in.
Right away, he was struck by this new story. And in 7 weeks, without interruption, he finished Psycho, the novel.
Over this footage from Stéphane Bourgoin's personal archives, Robert Bloch opened up about the American media's fascination for serial killers.
I think that the media is culpable.
To a great extent in
culpable to a great extent in its handling of the phenomena of serial killers. There's a sensationalism injected into these cases. And there's very little restraint when it comes to lengthy positions on attitudes, backgrounds, and the persona of the killer.
True to his convictions, Robert Bloch didn't commit to paper a carbon copy of Ed Gein. He cherry-picked certain horrific details of his story and invented a much more fascinating character. His pen transformed Ed Gein from farmer into motel owner, one who suffered from a split personality. He baptized his fictional character Norman Bates, the first two words the reader sees upon opening the book, Psycho.
He told me that Norman was close to normal, someone who is normal in his abnormality, so he wanted him to resemble Mr. Average.
Bates
Bates, he once told me, was a neighbor from his village that he hated, who had a dog, or two dogs, I don't recall. And these dogs barked all the time and woke him up at night. And when he asked him to quieten his dog or dogs, the dispute got pretty nasty. So it was his revenge on a bad-tempered neighbor.
The novel was finished in 1959. Yet despite the public's taste for the sordid misdeeds of Ed Gein, the book Psycho received a lukewarm reception. But one extremely favorable critique appeared in the New York Times, a newspaper read daily by Alfred Hitchcock. Mr. Block proved that a plausible story about mental illness could terrify and chill the blood. In the 1950s, Hitchcock released back-to-back hits, Rear Window, Vertigo, North by Northwest. At the same time, he enjoyed scaring television audiences with his cult show, Alfred Hitchcock Presents. His aim in 1959 was to shoot a low-key film with his TV crew, but without the economic constraints that went with major productions. And with the novel Psycho, he finally found his next subject. Norman Bates reminded him of another famous serial killer in his native England, Jack the Ripper.
Hitchcock got this fascination with strange, creepy serial killers from his boyhood, because he was raised in the same area of England that Jack the Ripper terrorized women and killed them. And that had happened before he was born. Nobody had caught Jack the Ripper, as far as anyone knew for sure, still to this day. And Jack the Ripper was, his name was spoken, you know, in that area all the time. Every few years, he goes all the way back to Jack the Ripper, and he brings it forward in time, making it contemporary. So when he sits around, you know, in about 1959, reading Robert Bloch's novel, I'm sure he went.
Hitchcock immediately bought the rights to the book. Robert Bloch's agent received an offer of $9,500, unaware with whom he was actually negotiating.
It was Hitchcock's habit to conceal his identity when buying the rights. So Robert Bloch's agent receives a blind proposal covering the book's adaptation for the screen. He's told it will be shot in black and white, so he automatically thinks it's a low-budget film, even though the letterhead is that of a major company, Universal Pictures.
The script remained faithful to the plot of the novel, but one crucial detail was changed. In the novel, Bates was a plump, rather disturbing man of around 40. On his screenwriter Joseph Stefano's initiative, Hitchcock turned him into a clean-cut young man, the kind of person about whom you'd say, oh, he wouldn't hurt a fly. Hitchcock then set his sights on an actor who was creating a buzz in the industry back then. Young Anthony Perkins.
Tony Perkins was not unknown, so I'm sure Hitchcock was watching him and thinking about him, and then this part came along, and together with his writers, and always the first writers are him and Alma, he and his wife. I'm sure they looked at Tony Perkins while they were thinking about who they were going to turn into the Norman Bates of the film.
The Hitchcocks were intrigued by the sexual ambiguity given off by Anthony Perkins, a troubling impression that would be put to great use in the character of Norman Bates.
Wow, he took Tony Perkins. And then as time goes on, and Tony Perkins, we realize, is gay or bisexual or what, however he defined himself, eventually he was married, Hitchcock's casting was genius.
In a way, he's the most lifelike killer we know. Because when we represent them or tell their stories, it's always staged in an exceptional way. They have a particular face, a certain look. They have a different disposition. They're extraordinary. So extraordinary that they spare us, the ordinary ones. But he's just like us. I don't think there's ever been a more insignificant killer. It reminds me of these reports. When they question someone who turns out to be a dangerous terrorist or an assassin, what do the neighbors say? Oh no, he was nice. Yes, he'd always say good morning. That's what we always hear.
For the leading female role, Alfred Hitchcock wanted the star Janet Leigh. Her cold, fantastical blonde beauty was exactly what the filmmaker loved. And on this movie, he was eager to push back the boundaries of what was politically correct for the time.
Viewers were attracted by the fact that we saw Janet Leigh in a bra on the poster for the movie, which was groundbreaking. We saw her twice in a bra in the movie, and he showed a toilet flushing on screen, something that had never been done.
But Alfred Hitchcock's ultimate stroke of genius was to eliminate the character played by Janet Leigh after only 30 minutes.
First, Marion Crane, who runs off with the stolen money. We start pulling for her, and bang, she's murdered after 20 or 30 minutes.
Yes, the viewers are totally stunned, because we usually identify with the main character, who is on screen for 20, 25 minutes. And suddenly, the heroine disappears. She's murdered in an ultra-violent way. And what we thought was the dramatic device of the movie, the theft of this money, disappears completely.